All right, I think it's 6:30. We'll call this meeting to order. Howard, if you'll determine if there's a quorum for us.
One, two, three, four, six present and one absent.
All right. We'll rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, moving along in our agenda, item number two, approval of the agenda. I'll entertain a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Just the agenda.
Could have been early.
Any discussion on this item? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. I don't see any recognitions and awards on my agenda, so we have nothing for our item number three on the agenda. That brings us to community comment. 3 minute time limit per speaker, 15 minute limit per topic. Do we have anyone from the community this evening who would like to speak? I always wait just a little bit to make sure. Not seeing anyone. We'll finish call item four finished and move on to the consent agenda. I'll entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All right, any discussion?
I'd like to pull out three contracts.
Okay.
The Director of Teaching and Learning, which is the old curriculum director, then the EL, curriculum director, and there was another name for something else, and the Director of Human Resources.
Do you want the ALC director to take it out too?
No.
Okay.
All right, so we now have a consent agenda, and we've removed the three items Richard has just mentioned. That's the teaching and learning. Repeat that for me. Make sure I have the teaching and learning
which
director,
is the old curriculum.
The ELL
scheme.
Director and the human resource director,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes.
Those are the three positions. Okay. So the consent agenda as you have it is absent those things at this time. Any other discussion on the consent agenda? Then we'll tackle those three items. Hearing no discussion, all those in favor of approval signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. All right, so we'll take each of those contracts individually. The Teaching and Learning Director, does somebody have handy what page of the agenda?
4 of 20. That's the cover letter that starts on page 5.
Page 12.
We're looking at slightly different formats of it.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay, so I have the Director of Teaching and Learning in front of me now. We have a recommendation. Any discussion on this item?
Well, maybe first of all,
is Colleen here?
Yeah, she is. Maybe I could introduce her and introduce the person that we are recommending for hire for the Director of Teaching and Learning, and that is Colleen Cordonuto. And Colleen, if you want to just stand, and if you guys have any questions for Colleen before you approve her, that would be just fine. Putting her on the spot. She doesn't have anything prepared here. So.
Well, welcome, Colleen. Would you mind just taking just a minute or so to tell us a little bit about your background?
I've been in education over 20 years. Want to give a little bit of background. I feel like I've been in education all my life because both of my parents were teachers, and so have been around a lot of staff members and et cetera as I was growing up. I was in California as a teacher for over 10 years, came back to Minnesota, was in Minneapolis, Burnsville, and spent the last 8 years as a Director of Teaching, Learning, and Assessment and New Prague Area Schools. And I am excited to be here and have this opportunity this evening.
Thank you, Colleen. Any other questions for Colleen?
I want to know what you learned in California.
Many things, I have to be honest. Coming from northern Minnesota and landing in California, it was quite a different lifestyle. And I learned a lot in the educational field, I have to be honest with you, and in the world itself.
And what kind of role did you have in California?
You know, when I first started my first year, you'll love this. My first year was a traveling physical education teacher. And thereafter, I spent 8 years teaching seventh grade science and then earned my master's degree and decided that I wanted to try something different. So went ahead and taught fourth grade for a year and a half before I decided to come back to Minnesota. At the same time, I was being trained in California in a leadership position. So I could be futuristic principal or et cetera. But and my dad was ill, so it was time to come home. So I'm back in Minnesota.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Colin. All right. Any further discussion on this item?
Is there a problem having two Colleens?
Was that considered in the hiring process? Is that, I don't know if that's a...
Nicole has already created a nickname for the for Uh-oh. Colleen. We have Colleen and we have CC. So.
Okay, at this time I'll entertain a motion to approve this contract for the Teaching and Learning Director.
Second.
No, you have to
I'll entertain the motion. So.
Oh, yeah, so moved.
Second.
I thought you wanted
to. We are off our game tonight, we apologize. I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. The next contract, how far down do I have to go
just
here?
Just a couple pages. A
few pages.
There we go.
Oh, that's area.
That's an area learning center.
Nope, yeah. Keep going. A couple more. I'm on a different cycle.
All right, so the ELL curriculum coordinator, on mine, this is page 21 of 164. Sure, everybody feels like they're there before we move forward. Okay, any items of the discussion on this?
I think you were going to say something, so I called you, that this is actually a savings. Could you maybe explain that to the group?
Yep, I can, and I'm going to rely on Colleen Merzdorf to help out if we need that help. But what we did is we have a need for some help with our ELL programs and then helping out with some of the leadership pieces. It's still not a solution to our ELL leadership pieces. It's just a component that I think is going to help out in the long run. So we wanted to assign some of these duties to a person that has an administration degree so they can help with some of the supervision. So we looked at that position and we added it to the assessment person. We changed the title of the assessment person in combination of the EL person to be EL and curriculum coordinator. So that's how the name came about. It's really the position of the assessment coordinator has taken on more job responsibilities. That's the bottom line. So we opened it up and we advertised it to see how many applicants we ended up with. We ended up with one applicant, and that was Angela McAndrews, and she was the previous assessment coordinator, and now that's who we're recommending tonight to be the EL and curriculum coordinator for that position. But as a result of opening that position up, we were able to use some Title III dollars, which is our dollars that we can use, our federal dollars that we can use to pay for someone to help out with ELL services. Before, we were paying that position completely out of general fund money, so now we're able to offset some of that money, and I don't know the total, about 25%. 25% of that position has now been offset as a result, saving 25% of their salary in the general fund. So it's actually an overall savings to the district by doing it this way, although I will also say that this person now has some more duties to do too. So that's kind of the complicated explanation, I guess.
Any other questions on this item?
When we are describing this position as a EL slash curriculum coordinator, is curriculum in reference to EL or overall curriculum?
That's related to overall curriculum. So just like the previous position that Angela had, she was the right-hand person for Joanne, our curriculum director. This person will still be that position, but in addition to what they were doing, they're also going to be helping out with the ELL supervision and help.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, any further questions on this item? Okay, I don't think we've done a motion in a second yet, so at this time I'll entertain a motion to approve the contract for the EL curriculum coordinator.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. All right. And finally, the last item removed from the consent agenda was the employment contract for the, I had it here 2 seconds ago, for the Human Resources Director. Questions or comments on this item?
I brought this up because everybody knows where I stand on this. A few years ago, in fact, myself and Ms. Davis was part of the board at that time where we cut the director to save money and we split duties among some other personnel. And that's been quite a few years. It seems to be working, but now we're bringing back a full-time director of human resources. And it's basically a $35,000 raise when we're in such a tight budget, you know, restraints. And I will be voting against this.
All right, other questions or comments on this item? I think it's important to note that what we have found over the last few years, though, is that, in fact, I think the administration would say it wasn't working, that the director position, that position was actually acting as more than was originally envisioned, that change hadn't been working. And so I forget what the study was, Todd, help me out.
The Springstead pay equity report.
The pay equity report sort of made it clear that we were asking this position duties which were commensurate with a director position. And so I think it's our duty to make sure it's paid as such. Other questions or comments? All right, hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to approve this contract.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the employment contract for the Human Resources Director. Let's go ahead and we'll do a roll call. Howard, we know there's going to be a no.
Okay, James Wolf.
Aye.
Jerry's not here. Richard?
No.
Jason?
Aye.
Deb?
Aye.
Tom?
Aye.
And I'm an aye for a 5-1.
Right. Motion carries 5-1. All right. That handles the item number 5, the consent agenda. We'll move on to the curriculum. Item number 6, curriculum. There's some minutes provided from the curriculum committee meeting. Tom, would you like to say anything about these minutes, or?
Well, I'll try not to duplicate everything in the minutes, just give you kind of a highlight and then respond to any questions or concerns you might have. I thought we had an excellent committee meeting on Thursday, April 12th. We had quite a number of parents in attendance again, which is always good in my opinion. The meeting was a little over an hour long. We spent some time reviewing the final list of cuts that had been approved at an earlier board meeting. There had, in the meeting prior to the one on the 12th, there had been a great deal of concern expressed by committee members about the impact of some of the proposed cuts at that time. And the impact on curriculum, and they were glad to see that so much had been able to be protected at least for one more year. Most of the rest of the meeting involved discussion revolving around the idea of a levy, and there was a long discussion about the need to build trust within the community as we propose, talk about a levy if we propose one and move forward with that. There was a lot of discussion about the fact that some items that had been presented for possible approval at a previous levy that were not voted up in the levy, but were retained. And I recognize that there's some complicating issues there in terms of we were voting for, I believe the previous levy had a statement to the effect of assuring continued funding for all day everyday kindergarten and that sort of thing. But there was some feeling from committee members that the fact that that appeared to be a contradiction was a factor in making it less of a trustful situation between the school district and the community. We had two motions, the first of which was that they want to encourage our superintendent to be a strong voice in the levy process. The board and leadership must be very transparent and specific in the levy proposal, and the board must be committed to follow through with stated proposals whether the levy passes or fails. And I think that reflects back on the idea that whatever, as Ms. Freund mentioned at an earlier meeting, that we have a product to propose should we go with a levy, and that we have to be very specific about that. And the committee was very strongly in favor of encouraging us as a board and as a school district to be specific and follow through with whatever would be required. There was the second motion. And I'm going to back up just for a moment. There was some very positive statements about a recent article that Mr. Sesker had published in the Faribault Daily News, and they would like to see, that to continue, whether it comes from Mr. Sesker or others, but that kind of communication is very important. And related to that was our second motion involving that the committee would like to request that it, or saying, we're saying that it is important for someone, whether that be the superintendent, board members, finance director, to clarify for the public the process that was used in determining final cuts approved at our March meeting. And that was in reference to the idea of found money. The lack of trust that some of the citizens on our committee have felt over years was the idea that somehow there are money to be found. And the fact that our budget decision in March required us to tap into our fund balance and borrow against or borrow money or take money back from a our retirement severance. Am I referring to that correctly?
Yep. I call it OPEB. Easier. Yeah.
Whatever he calls it, yep, is fine. But yep, the fact that we were able to reduce the amounts of cuts that we had been considering because, not because we found any money, but because we made a choice to use fund balance money and borrow back against the account that was mentioned before. And the committee wanted that to be made as transparent or as clear to the public as possible, in the sense that, again, that will build trust, and that's what it's going to take to be successful with any levy that would appear. And we're going to have another meeting here in May, hoping to get, and I believe Ms. Ostrom has scheduled Mr. Sesker and Ms. Mettendorf for that meeting. And I'm sorry, I tried to look up the changed date. I'd had, the original plan was the 15th, is that, or maybe it, not the last plan is the 15th, this is accurate, all right, excuse me, the, on Tuesday, May 15th. And so I encourage anyone interested to attend, but we're hoping to get some detailed information about that.
Did they change that date to, what, I had it on the 10th at 3:30. It, okay, it is 50. All right, just want to make sure. Yeah, memory's losing it. So 15th, all right, thanks. I just wanted to double check. So it is the 15th.
Okay, it is the 15th, yes. I it was on one date and then moved, and I lost track of which was which. And lastly, we had some brief discussion about the role of the curriculum committee, which I think has been pulling itself together here over the last few months. But in looking forward to next year and examining the ways in which our district is addressing our expanded vision of student achievement, that we want as a committee and personally want to do what we can to make sure that our system is actively pursuing that wider vision as we adopt.
Any questions for Tom? Thank you, Tom. All right, hearing none, move along to item 7, policy on our agenda. We have some minutes. Does someone from the policy committee want to report on that?
I can talk about those. I do want to make sure everyone knows that we're taking after Jason's good teaching, and we had a 45-minute meeting. It was great, let me tell you. So basically we brought forth some policies that we needed to review, the internet acceptable use and safety policy we're bringing forward for the first reading, search of student lockers, desks, personal possessions, and student persons. We got some clarification from the police liaisons on what they wanted to see in the policy. So we're bringing that for the first reading. They made a minor change, and that was it. School board officers, we were bringing that for first reading. There was a minor language change from MSBA. Student medications, we actually tabled that policy to get some more information. So we'll be discussing that at our next meeting. And then Kathy found some policies that we need to rescind because we have already adopted new policies about students and employees with communicable diseases. And then we also tabled another administrative director evaluation to get some more information about that policy before we discuss it. And our next meeting is Monday, May 14th at 6.
Okay, we have some policies then for first reading. Policy 202, school board officers, 502, search of student lockers, desk personal, and policy 524, internet acceptable use and safety. Any questions on those at this time? We won't be taking action tonight, but I'm sure they'll be back then next month for our second reading. So.
I just want to say that under duties of the treasurer, it says I'll make the deposits, and I've never done that.
It also says in there further down that you can delegate that duty. So.
Exactly how many duties can we delegate?
Quite a bit for that, because I think if you read that, it talks about the treasurer signing checks and stuff also.
I don't think it says that.
The treasurer actually has like the largest responsibilities and stuff. The clerk actually has more, sorry. So, which we delegate a lot of those. Because it says the clerk shall draw and sign all orders upon the treasurer for the payment of money for bills allowed by the school board for salaries of officers and the teacher's wages and all claims to be countersigned by the chair.
So where does it say, Deb?
It's,
that some duties can be.
Just that
I think it's under three, under organization. It just says you can the person who performs those duties of the clerk and treasurer need not be members of the school board.
Just the treasurer's in charge of that.
He's supposed to make sure everyone does that. Just as the clerk is supposed to make sure all the duties under his are getting done.
So I guess that's what 3A and B says.
Any other questions on any of these policies? Like I said, they're here just for first reading, so we won't be taking any action on them. If you come up with more questions on these policies, please direct them to the policy committee. All right, and so item 7C then, consider rescission and abolishment of the following policies. And we heard Deb mentioned earlier that there's a couple of policies that we actually replaced a few years ago and did not rescind the ones, the policies that were being replaced at that time, which would be our normal practice. So these are policy 405.8, students and employees with communicable diseases, and 504.2, students and employees with, what's the difference between those two?
It's the same policy, and it's cross-referenced.
I see. It's the same policy in two different places. Okay.
And it's replaced by policy 420.
So I think it's okay to take that as one motion for both of those policies together. So at this time, I'll entertain a motion to rescind policies 405.8 and 504.2, students and employees with communicable diseases.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All right, hearing none, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. All right. Item number 8, Finance Committee. Starting with the minutes and the treasurer's report.
Okay, we have two sets of minutes because at our March meeting, the Finance Committee had met the morning of the board meeting, so the minutes were not ready, and so they have not officially been approved by the board, but all the action from that meeting was taken, and so we don't need to review that. It's just for board approval at this time. So I'd make a motion to approve the minutes of the March 13th and the April 9th meeting.
I don't think we approve minutes.
Oh, we don't. You're right. It doesn't say action there.
Okay. Any questions for James on those meetings before we move on to the individual items recommended to us by the Finance Committee? All right, hearing none, we have a number of items brought to us by the Finance Committee. Item 8B1, approve interagency agreement between Faribault Public Schools and Tri-Valley Opportunity Council, Elysian Area Learning Center for the Migrant Head Start Program. Todd, do you want to say anything about that item?
Sure. Or James, if you want to, go ahead.
Or
Colleen, any one of us, and Cheryl.
There we go.
I can start. It's okay. I can get it started, Cheryl, and you can fill in, pass the buck.
Thank you for stepping forward, Cheryl.
It is an agreement between Waterville, Legion, Morristown, and it's an ALC within the community, and it does work with our special education population, our ALC population. So maybe, Cheryl, if you can talk to that about.
Just quickly, we are required under Child Find, State Statute 300.111, to have in place procedures that help us to locate students that have disabilities, and that includes migrant populations as well. And there are areas around the state that have centers, and one of the centers is in Elysian. And so as part of that process, we are in a relationship with them, in an interagency relationship, to identify and serve students that have disabilities within those migrant populations that come to work as seasonal workers. And it just outlines our relationship here and the steps and processes to identify students and serve them across that are our residents, Faribault residents, during that time.
Any questions for Cheryl?
This has been a program that we've done for years, correct?
For years, right. Nothing new.
Hearing no questions, other questions, I'll entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second to approve the interagency agreement between Faribault Public Schools and Tri-Valley Opportunity Council, Elysian Area Learning Center for the Migrant Head Start Program. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Item 8B2, approve Abbott Summer Bridge Implementation Agreement.
Now we approved something similar to that last month, right? Another Abbott program I noticed in the minutes of the March meeting.
Right. And this one is for the summer program. It's an Abbott program. It comes through our integration grant that Cheryl Curry has written, and the Finance Committee's reviewed it. And
yes, we did. Oops, just lost.
And there's details, and I don't know if you want, how many more details you want. It's part of our grant that we work with the ELL population.
Any questions on this program? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the Abbott Summer Bridge Implementation Agreement. Any further questions? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Item 8B3, approve Luther College Faribault Public Schools Field Experience Contractual Agreement for 2012-2013.
Again, this is just a contract we have. We do this with a lot of different colleges where they have a student teacher placement, and in this case, Luther sends a contract to the school district, making sure it's okay to place their teachers in Faribault if they want to do some student teaching. There's a contract where, and I believe actually in Faribault, we pay the teacher the stipend that Luther College gives us to have that student teacher in place. So,
any further questions on this item?
How many places do we get student teachers from? How many colleges?
Well, we you know, our largest one is from Minnesota State University Mankato. We get a few. I know we, of course, Luther. I don't know if we've gotten some from St. Olaf and Carleton or not. Do we get a few?
A few.
So I would say around the surrounding. Usually, you know, Luther's quite a drive. Normally we don't get student teachers from that far away. But so I would say the majority come from Mankato State.
Any further questions? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
I'll second that.
So we have a motion and a second to approve the Luther College Faribault Public Schools Field Experience Contractual Agreement for 2012-2013.
Yeah.
Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Item 8B4, approve the Riverbend Nature Center contract for 2012-2013.
Well, we pretty much approved this when it made it to the list of cuts, so the Finance Committee took that as concomitant to board approval. So I'll make a motion. We officially approve it at this point in time.
Okay. So we have a motion to approve. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Is this pretty much the same contract we've had in the past?
Yes.
Yep. It's $1,000 more than we paid last year.
But the programs are essentially the same?
Yep.
Todd, do you know if we've had any further discussion about perhaps finding secondary sources of funding, grants or such things for?
We haven't looked at that yet, but that's certainly a possibility for some of these
we
things.
We talked about that when the budget discussion was there, and I think it couldn't hurt perhaps to help insulate them from future budget issues.
Right.
Think about that, at least what might be a possibility.
Mm-hmm.
All right, we have a motion and a second to approve the Riverbend Nature Center contract for 2012-2013. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Item 8B5, approve the CREC expanded focus program and the 18 to 21 transition program lease.
Right, this is to allow us to get the square footage we need to house the programs that we've previously approved. This is the old, still I think of it as the old lumber yard building. It just expands that lease a little bit, but it's for programs that have already been approved.
And correct me if I'm wrong.
And it's split 50-50 as noted in the cover note with Northfield.
With Northfield, right. Correct me if I'm wrong, but these are programs that we've had a number of discussions on, Trail, correct, already at our board meetings. So this is just implementing those programs formally that we've discussed in the past.
Correct.
Any further comments, questions?
And we control the whole building now, is that correct?
Yeah, we lease the whole
building. We lease the whole.
Yes.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments?
Any other changes to the contract?
Other than square footage, I think that was it.
There are no other changes.
Nope.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion at this time to approve.
Right.
Have we done that already?
No.
I don't
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the CREC expanded focus program and the 18 to 21 transition program lease. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Item 8B6, approve summer food service program contract with Sodexo.
Okay, we can actually take 6, 7, and 8. May we need separate motions, but they all have to do with the same program, and that's because of our high percentage of free and reduced lunches. We now qualify to offer free breakfast and lunch during the summertime, and so we're contracting with Sodexo to make that happen, and with the bus company provide transportation. And transportation contract as well, somebody to ride the bus.
And then supervisors for the program.
Right.
Yep. And then a bullet.
So 6, 7, and 8 are all tied together.
And Lori Deal is here to talk about the contract with Sodexo if we have any questions. You don't have to speak to the bus contract unless you want to.
Does anybody see a reason why we couldn't take action on 6, 7, and 8 together? I don't know. Maybe there is a reason. Hmm. Not hearing any objections,
I'll make a motion to approve 6, 7, and 8.
Second.
Right, we have a motion and a second, and I'll read off all three items. To approve the Summer Food Service Program contract with Sodexo, that's item number 6. Item 7 is to approve the Summer Food Service Transportation contract with Faribault Transportation Company. And item number 8, to approve the Summer Food Service Program supervisory position. So all those items are related to the same program. Any further questions or comments on these?
Just one final comment. Thanks to Colleen for all of your hard work for setting this up, and also Lori, who had both those two did a great job of getting this program that I think is going to be very valuable for our community this summer. And I just wanted to thank both of them publicly for all their hard work.
Yeah, and I would just second what Todd has just said. Of course, it's not a good thing that the poverty is at such a high level in our community, but given that it is, the fact that we can provide lunch to kids who are need this program and need to learn
and breakfast
and
breakfast.
Lunch and breakfast is a good thing. So I thank you guys also for your hard work.
I concur with that. I do have how many students do we anticipate participating in?
That is the challenge, and here to answer that question is Lori. So.
As many as possible.
That would be good, yes.
No, we hope 100 to 300 maybe for breakfast, which is why we aren't having the transportation. We kind of want to focus on lunch. Lunch could anywhere 300 to 500 plus per day. So we're picking one site, the high school, with not knowing how many to predict, how many might be biking, walking, dropped off, coming by bus. I just need one site. You know, it's like planning a dinner party. You've invited the whole city, but you're not sure who's coming. So hopefully, the high school is also the biggest where we could have the biggest cafeteria and the biggest freezer space as well. Okay. So,
how are we notifying the community?
It's going to book a bulletin, daily news. Hopefully, we'll run a couple of articles on that as well. Colleen and I have set up an appointment to get that coverage. The newsletters, last report card. I've already gotten phone calls. Word is out there already,
good,
but as much as possible. And then I'll go out and to the library, community centers, every possible place we can find, we'll get the word out.
We're translating into
3 languages right now. Anything else? And I invite all of you to come too. We have plenty of aprons in here now.
any more questions or comments on these items?
Tom still has to wear a hairnet, right?
Well, custom made.
Just duct tape.
Yep.
Hearing no further comments or questions, we already have a motion and a second to approve these 3 items. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. All right, item 8B9, the bulletin discussion on community education.
Yeah, I didn't know we were gonna have, we missed that one on our pre-conference.
I know,
so, yeah, so,
I didn't
sorry
see
about
it on that.
That
one, but it's here.
I put it on there. I think that Jerry wanted to talk about it, but I don't know how much discussion you wanna have with the bulletin, so it was kind of his request to talk about the bulletin. We've talked about it quite a bit, and we certainly have some numbers if you want to share those, if you have questions about it. But I guess our suggestion is to, we'll just support the city going to their 3 newsletters, and we'll try to do our part on our own. And I think we can do some things with our own, with the money that they're asking for us to pay too. So that was our discussion internally, and we really didn't have any reason to put it on the agenda other than that Jerry had wanted to see it on there too for possible discussion.
I thought we were going to see the cost of the different approaches, so I think too.
Yeah, we have that. So.
Okay, so we did a little calling around and got some quotes for you on different things. Let me just show you first the Buckham Bulletin. You're all familiar with it. You know, so it's a big piece of paper. So what we have in here is generally 6 of these big pages, which translates to 12 pages when you go to a bulletin this size that other communities have. Okay. So for the city, they talked about giving us those 12 pages for 3 issues and possibly 14 pages for that 4th issue at a cost of about $24,000 for those 12 to 14 pages in every issue. We got 2 quotes, and the company that was the lowest can give us 28 pages like this in color for about $27,000. So we're getting more than double the pages for almost the same cost. So I think we can expand what we're presenting to the community in community ed and give more community ed more of its own identity and its own presence if we go that route. So it was definitely worth it, and we can adjust those pages up or down however we see fit.
Does that include any mailing?
Pardon me?
Does that include any mailing?
Mailing costs on both is included in that 24 and 27,000.
Beyond the city limits?
Yes. Yep. Costs us about $1,100 to mail the Buckham Bulletin. It goes out, I think the post office told us it was about a little over 13,000 that they send out. And then the city, I think, has some out-of-town addresses that they send to that are district residents.
Will we accept notices from some other organizations, and what would be the parameters on that?
Yeah, I think that's
to be determined.
Yeah, we'll have to let Anne-Marie determine that when she gets on board, but certainly there'd be
an option to do that.
And what is the timing of when we're going to get our first one out versus when we're not going to be using the Buckham Bulletin and her arrival? Is that all going to mesh somehow?
Hopefully.
Yeah, and I would say our first one would go out in August, right before school, so everybody has that information prior to school start.
Okay. Any further questions or comments on this item? Thank you, Colleen. Thank you, Todd. Item 8C, budget, the enrollment report. Glad to see you didn't sit down, Colleen.
Okay, so we have an unusual phenomenon happening, the first time it's happened in my time here. We actually went up in enrollment from the prior month. So that's good news. I don't know why that is, but I had the principal say they have been enrolling students. It's definitely unusual this late in the year to be doing that, but you know, we'll take it. It's good news. So up a little bit.
All right, any questions on that? Not hearing any. Item 8C2, the financial report. Any questions or comments on our financial report? All right. Last we have item 8C. Three, consider the acceptance of gifts and donations. We have warrant and gift in front of us tonight from CNS Vending for a bun coffee maker for the Lincoln Elementary School, a value of $200. So we thank them for that that donation. I'll entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second to approve this gift. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Right, motion carries. Item 9, other committee reports. I have on here an item for the insurance committee meetings minutes, but I don't see us having gotten any.
Did not get them yet.
Okay, so we don't have any minutes in front of us?
I was there, though, but
okay,
not
you,
much.
Would you like to report?
I'd like to,
sure.
Maybe Colleen can fill in the blanks, but really not much going on, except that they're having the meetings with the staff for insurance purposes, switching insurance. Is that true? Trying to get everybody into Aviva? Is that?
Yes. We got really good news on our renewal. We had gone into a two-year agreement last year with Blue Cross Blue Shield. Where last year we actually had a reduction in our premiums. We had a rate guarantee of 5% increase for this next year. We ended up with a 1.3, so that was really good news that the district received. So that was kind of the biggest thing, and now we've got all of the rates for next year. We've got all the products lined up, so as Richard indicated, we are having meetings with all the staff various times and various locations to give everyone an opportunity to attend and be informed about the VBA and the HSA and the HRAs, because it's fairly new to Faribault, and those are really good products to help contain costs. So we're hoping that a lot of employees will take advantage of that.
Any more questions? Okay, hearing none, we'll move on to item 9B, the Wellness Committee minutes. You have the minutes in front of you. Is there anyone who would like to report on that meeting at all?
Well, I was there. I mean, it was another good meeting. We are looking into some grants. We don't have any grants that have been approved yet, but we're looking into some of those. And we also talked about bicycle safety and possibly putting on some bicycle safety courses. It was a good meeting. It was one of those 45-minute meetings, too.
All right. Any questions on that? All right, hearing none, we are on to item 10, other matters. Item 10A, The approval of the 2011 to 2015 Faribault Education Association Memorandum of Understanding. Todd, do you want to tell us a little bit about that memorandum?
Yeah, sure. This is the agenda item that you tabled from the last meeting. We had our four-hour budget discussion. We got to the point where a lot of us were a little tired, so I thought it made more sense to put it on this agenda when you can understand it and go through it and ask questions about it. This is something that the district has approved, I think, almost every year for the last, what, 5 or 6 years it's been. And in a nutshell, if you have a staff member that is thinking about retiring mid-year, this gives the district an option and the staff member an option to allow them to take a leave and then at the same time allow the district to go out and hire somebody. And hopefully you can hire somebody at an earlier date rather than trying to find somebody that may be thinking about retiring in November. It gets really tough if you have somebody that decides to retire in November, especially if it's a chemistry or an English or some of those other more difficult courses. There's other courses too. But if we can somehow get it so that the person decides to retire ahead of time and give us ample time to find a replacement, then that helps both the district and the employee out. So it's I believe it's a good decision for both the Faribault Education Association and the school board. Nicole has a little bit more history than what I do on this. If you have real specific questions, she may be able to help you out on that too.
I would just say most of them that I recall that coming through are not people sort of mid-year. They're asking for a five-year leave of absence, which to me was a new phenomenon. And I just wonder, is this common in other schools? I certainly know of no other professions where people get a five-year leave of absence generally prior to retirement. And it seems to me we're losing some of our best senior people 5 years earlier. I mean, what does it say about their, you know, that people want to leave 5 years before they're done, in a sense? I mean, that's another question of interest, but just from a practical point of view, to be paying for these benefits for somebody who isn't serving the district seems very strange to me.
Do you want to talk about that, Nicole, a little bit, just give some history?
That is a possibility where they can take a five-year, the way the language is worded is it's an up to a five-year leave of absence. So for the most part, they generally come and request the most. And then if they inform us generally within that next year that they're going to retire. It's just basically to get them to the rule of 90. If they know, if they can see the light at the end of the tunnel where they're really looking towards retirement, this helps get them to the end, to their rule of 90, so that they can retire, and then we are able to hire someone with less disruption to the classroom, like Todd had said, if it is going to happen mid-year. They can go for 5 years, though, so, and it has happened.
Some regularity.
The state does also have a statutory extended leave of absence for teaching staff as well, which is a 3 to 5 year extended leave of absence, which is real similar to this leave. There are a few requirements that they have to meet in order to take that leave of absence, a few less requirements, whereas this one says they have to be on step 12 of our teaching contract. So most times that means they've worked for us for at least 12 years going into their 13th year prior to being eligible to request this leave. The other part of the leave gives the option to take a part-time leave. The part-time leave is nice when you're looking at ULAs down the road or reductions in some specific areas. A lot of times what happens is the more senior teacher will then request a part-time leave of absence in hopes to keep a younger teacher who's been in the district for a while, like maybe a teacher who's teaching German who can see retirement towards the end of, real soon, will, instead of continuing on with their full-time position, they will take a part-time leave of absence to save the more, the younger teacher that will be with us for a longer period of time. those two options. Either they can take a full-time up to 5-year leave of absence or a part-time up to 5-year leave of absence.
Does this cost the district any money because of this policy?
Well, what happened, the way to look at it is, it does. During the leave of absence, they're eligible to receive $400 a month towards their health insurance benefits. And in addition to that, the district pays their percentage of their TRA into their Minnesota State Retirement System or their health savings account. So we pay those two things for those teachers. At the same time, which roughly, looking at a teacher who's making $60,000 a year is roughly just shy of $9,000 a year between the TRA contributions and the health insurance contributions each year. Now, if you look at replacing a $60,000 a year teacher with a $40,000 a year teacher, you're still saving money while you're paying those benefits. You're still saving $11,000.
Now, the rule of 90 doesn't apply to the young teachers, right?
Right.
Or
anybody who was hired after 1989 or 87.
89 or 87.
I think it's 89. I don't remember, one of those dates. Anybody hired after 87 or 89 doesn't get the rule of 90.
Okay. All right. Any more questions on this item? Wonderful. Hearing none, I will entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second to approve the 2011 to 2013 Faribault Education Association Memorandum of Understanding. Any further questions or comments on this item?
I just have, this is a clarification because we've taken all the action, but tonight we approved a 5-year leave of absence for Margaret Gare and then we hired her as a new ALC director. How does that all work?
That's a little bit different than what this is. Nicole, you want to go through that one again, too? There's a little difference in that piece. I'll let her explain.
Okay, so currently Margaret Gare is a teacher for us. She's now taking on the position as an ALC director. So because she's been at the district for over 5 years, or 10 years for a Minnesota school district, she's eligible to take the Minnesota statutory leave of absence, the extended leave of absence, which is the 3 to 5 year leave. So she can request a 5-year leave of absence, and during that 5 years, she still retains all of her seniority rights, and we continue giving her years of service as if she's been an active teacher for us for 5 years, and then at the end of that 5 years, she has to decide if she's going to go back into the teaching.